reached out and invited Senator Cassilly to join us again, because now that the vote has been taken, this is going to become effective today. And so Senator Cassilly joins us. Senator Cassilly, I really appreciate you taking time on such short notice to kind of come in and respond to this. But what can you tell us about today's decision and the nature of the discussion and debate around this?
Sure, Tori. Hi. Good to be here. So this was a hearing today by the, it's called the AELR Committee, which is the Committee of the Administrative, Legislative and Executive Review Committee, which is a standing committee of the General Assembly. It's both House and Senate. It's about 24 members, I think. And we very rarely have hearings. So today was one of those rare exceptions. And our responsibility is to review all regulations that are all proposed regulations. And then if members want a hearing on it, they can opt for hearing. And we very rarely opt for hearing, but in this case, some of the members did opt for hearing. So we did have about a 3 or 4 hour hearing today with the superintendent of schools and the president of the board, as well as about 40 or so parents, 30 or 40 parents were each given a couple of 2 minutes to chime in on both sides of the issue. It was fairly organized and cooperative kind of groups, but the most of the parents were concerned about whether there was actually a scientific basis to require masking, and on their side we have the fact that the state regulation requires a piece of cloth over a child's face, and that's it. It doesn't, you talk anything from a full mask, a big M90 mask, all the way down to your average piece of cotton tissue affixed around the ears to cover the nose and mouth. And the question was whether the state board could mandate that, and that's all the regulation says, is that everybody has to wear a piece of cloth that covers the mouth and nose. It doesn't have any requirements for it. And a lot of the parents were concerned that this having young kids wear these masks for 8 hours a day, covering their faces, was physically unhealthy, and because it allows for disease and the light to grow, you're providing very little in the way of prevention mechanisms with children touching and interacting there was no mandate, for example, on hand washing, and they are allowed to remove these and converse while eating and other times in the school. So a lot of the parents felt that this was simply a power grab, a naked power grab, and that it did not allow for the variances throughout the state. And to their credit, I mean, you do look at the COVID dashboard that the state has out right now, and the rates are pretty drastically different across the state. And then, of course, school buildings are different. Some have windows that open, some don't have windows that open. Some have nice big lawns that kids can go out on and hang out. Others have no such facilities. So to move this to a state mandate just removes that flexibility that a local board could say, we'll move classes outside or what have you. And also removes their ability to be more strict if they wanted to, in certain cases, if their, say, windows weren't opening, if the school wanted to be, have greater restrictions on what the mask would be all about. But in the end, I think what my colleagues and I came down to the conclusion was it was just one more step in the educational power grab. We saw this for the last 2 years in General Assembly, where the state is once again reaching out to shut off local control, local discretion, educational decisions, while the bureaucracy at the state level comes down in mandates. This was, we were not discussing whether a county could on its own decide to require masks. That was not the issue. The issue is whether this would be a state power grab and force masks, or we would leave it up to the county boards of education working with their departments of health. And I think the one thing that became apparent is that the state superintendent and the president really had no greater insight on all of this than the local boards of education do. There's really not any more information that they have, and it was sort of just substituting the decision by one set of people who have their masters and PhDs in early childhood education versus the local people who have various master's degrees in other other areas. We didn't get our state board of education version of Dr. Fauci concludes X. This was education experts saying what the health requirements would be. So,
all right, we're speaking with State Senator Bob Cassilly, and actually we're nearly out of time, so I will go ahead and just ask this and say, what can you tell us about the discussion about discipline? Like, what are the enforcement mechanisms that school jurisdictions can have?
It was specifically asked, could a child be suspended for refusing to comply? And the response was, though, they would certainly very strongly discourage that we would basically just discuss this with the kids. So their view is, well, kids comply with this stuff more than adults do, and they don't foresee problems, but that if the kids don't want to wear it, you know, they'll deal with that on a case by case. And as far as jurisdictions go, if a jurisdiction refuses to comply, that they can either withhold educational funding or take that jurisdiction into court. Those are the two remedies they specifically discussed. But it was clear that they were not going to sit back and allow counties to ignore the state mandate.
Well, Senator Cassilly, thank you so much for taking time to join us on our program. Thank you for the work that you and your colleagues are doing to craft policies for our state. Please have a safe afternoon.